Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome. I'm Barry Pavel. I'm a vice president here at the Atlantic Council and director of the Brent Scowcroft Center on International Security. And we're so honored and thrilled to be here for a conversation with two very, very distinguished guests, California Governor Jerry Brown and former Secretary of Defense William Perry. And they'll engage in a discussion on reducing the threats posed by nuclear weapons. I'd love to thank Governor Brown and First Lady Ann Gus Brown and Secretary Perry for joining us today, and my colleague Joe Cirincione and the Plowshares Fund, thank you so much for partnering with us on this event, and the Honorable Jan Lodal, who's been working on these issues for so long, is a board director here and former president of the Atlantic Council. He'll take the stage shortly to provide introductory remarks, and other Atlantic Council board directors and all of you here today, thank you. This is obviously a very timely topic as the 2016 Nuclear Security Summit kicks off a few blocks from here. I assume none of you had traffic problems or anything getting here. But nonetheless, a vitally important set of topics that in particular, that numerous administrations, but in particular this administration, has been quite focused on for quite a while, and vitally important in today's context of increasing challenges from a variety of state actors and non-state actors around the world. Realizing greater nuclear security is the issue at hand for the dozens of international leaders in Washington today and tomorrow for the fourth and almost certainly final summit of its kind in this administration. The 2016 summit will include a dedicated session on reducing the threat that non-state actors like ISIS could acquire and use nuclear materials might pose. We can only imagine the horrific effect of introducing nuclear materials or weapons into the types of attacks that we've recently witnessed in Brussels, in Istanbul, in Paris, et cetera. Governor Brown and Secretary Perry recognize the grave danger posed to all nations by actors threatening to acquire and use nuclear materials, and they are concerned with the same questions as the heads of state at today's summit. They're here today to discuss how to address these problems after the conclusion of the 2016 summit. What are the opportunities to build off of the results of these four summits? In what key areas have the summits, could the summits have done more work? What are some new frameworks, new mechanisms, new approaches that can better secure the world against nuclear weapons? And I have to say, coming as the Obama administration was coming in, this was a very significant agenda item even before inauguration by this administration, and having run the Nuclear Posture Review when I was at the National Security Council in 2009-2010, this issue had the most prominence I've seen in our government in such strategic reviews for quite a long time. Now let me turn to introducing our speakers briefly. A mathematician by education, it's one of the few things I share with Secretary Perry. Secretary Perry has previously served as the Undersecretary of Research and Engineering, as Deputy Secretary of Defense, and of course as the 19th Secretary of Defense for the United States. He's now the Michael and Barbara Berberian Professor Emeritus at Stanford University, a senior fellow at the Freeman Spogli Institute, director of the Preventative Defense Project, and many, many, many other endeavors that Secretary Perry engages on. Governor Brown is a native of San Francisco, is currently serving a historic fourth term as governor of California. He previously served in a variety of positions, from trustee for the Los Angeles College District to California Secretary of State to Mayor of Oakland to California Attorney General, and the list goes on. A number of accomplishments in all of those areas, which you'll see in your biographies that you have in the materials today. Before their remarks, the Honorable Jan Lodal will provide an introduction. Mr. Lodal served as president here at the Council from 2005 to 6. He's currently a member of the Board of Directors and a distinguished fellow with the Atlantic Council and chairman of Lodal and Company. He served also in a variety of positions, from serving Henry Kissinger on the National Security Council to the principal deputy undersecretary of defense for policy, the number two person in policy in the Clinton administration, and a number of other positions, as I said. This is a public event, as I mentioned. We're all tweeting. I'll be tweeting when I'm not asking questions. The hashtag is ACDefense, and the account will be at ACScowcroft. So without further ado, please let me welcome Jan Lodal to the stage.
Thank you. Thanks, Barry. I just want briefly to say a few more things about our two speakers today that might not be so obvious and might not be in their biographies. Even when I first saw this, I thought, Jerry Brown's coming here on a nuclear thing, on the day of the nuclear summit. This is terrific. Maybe he'll go to the nuclear summit and pick up its energy for us today. And it really is very, very fortunate for us to have him involved in this issue, because he has been involved in this issue for his entire life and his entire career. He's made it very clear that he sees this issue, along with climate change, as being perhaps the two most important existential issues that mankind faces. And Bill Perry has had exactly the same path in his life. He has recently written a wonderful memoir called My Journey at the Nuclear Brink. And in this memoir, he states that he has seen throughout his whole career the challenge of preventing the use of nuclear weapons as being his greatest challenge and what he is most focused on. And since he's left office, he's put almost his entire focus on this particular issue. So we have two gentlemen here who have a lifetime of experience of dealing with this. Governor Brown has particularly focused on how to get the public to understand it and to appreciate it and get more public involvement. Dr. Perry has focused on that significantly, particularly with a focus on young people and bringing them to understand it better. He's had a distinguished career in academia. He's taught many of us what we know about this subject and many others as well, and tried to spread the knowledge more widely within the academic community as well. Governor Brown, of course, has not shied away from working on trying to solve the problems that he sees, and he's done things that make it clear to people how dramatic these problems are. When California faced its water crisis more than a year ago, rather than just complaining about it and whining and so forth, he immediately put in place a 25% reduction. Everyone said it wouldn't work, and in fact, it did work, and he knew that it was going to work. This is the kind of energy that we all hope to see put on the nuclear problem as we go forward. The same thing is true about Dr. Perry. He has, for many years, focused on the issue at its core, and of course with Secretary Shultz and Senator Nunn and Secretary Perry, the four of them wrote this path-breaking editorial near the beginning of the Obama administration, calling for an end to nuclear weapons and a world without nuclear weapons, which really changed people's way of thinking altogether about this subject. So it's my honor to turn the floor over to Dr. Perry, who will make some comments to you, and after that, Governor Brown, and then we'll open it up for, as Barry said, for a open discussion. Thank you very much. Bill.
Thank you very much, Dan. Well, I am a child of the Cold War, as are some of the rest of you in this audience today. And as such, I've always had a deep concern about nuclear issues, about the danger we faced of a nuclear catastrophe during the Cold War. But my main message to you today is that the danger of a nuclear catastrophe today, I believe, is greater than it was during the Cold War. Greater than during the Cold War. That's my first message. The second message is that I believe our public, if that's true, our public is generally unaware of that. They are blissfully unaware of that. Consequently, the policies that this country follows are in no ways commensurate with the danger. And so I see my job as trying to educate the public on this issue, which is a huge task, but nevertheless, that's what I am undertaking. Now, to make my point to this sophisticated audience, let me explain briefly why I made that first statement, why I think the dangers are today greater than during the Cold War. So I'll compare them during the Cold War. It's hard to do it without looking at the different ways in which a nuclear catastrophe could occur. During the Cold War, we believed that we were in danger of what we called a boob, a bolt out of the blue, a surprise strike. In retrospect, it seems that danger was greatly overstated. But whether it was real or whether it was not real, it was absolutely clear that our policies were driven by that belief. It's the primary reason why we ended up with 70,000 nuclear weapons. We're just driven by the belief there was going to be a surprise attack and we had to prepare for it. Whether or not that was true, it was certainly true that there was a great danger that we run into a war by miscalculation, and certainly the Cuban Missile Crisis was a primary example of that, where we almost did blunder into nuclear war by miscalculation. At the time, I believe that we avoided a nuclear catastrophe more by good luck than by good management. And everything I've learned since then has only confirmed my view that is true. Beyond miscalculation, we all during the Cold War were at risk of a nuclear war being caused by accident. There are many ways that accident could occur, but the most obvious was through a false alarm. And we had at least three false alarms in the United States that I'm personally aware of. I don't know how many there might have been in the Soviet Union. One of these false alarms I personally participated in, and I got a call from the watch officer of North American Air Defense, man, woke me up from a sound sleep, telling me, he started his conversation by telling me that his computers were showing 200 ICBMs on the way from the Soviet Union to the United States. Now, an event like that gets your attention. And I've never really forgotten that morning. Of course, it was a false alarm. Why was he calling me? I was, at the time, Under Secretary of Defense for Research and Engineering. Why would he be calling me? He was calling me because he knew he had to brief the president in the morning, and he wanted to figure out what the hell had gone wrong with his computers, and he was hoping I could help him figure that out. Without dwelling on that case anymore, I just say I was not able to over the phone that night. It took us 2 days to discover that it was human error, that the sergeant coming on watch that day put the wrong tape into the computer. He put a training tape into the computer. That's a real story. So during the Cold War, we had the danger, a real danger, of a war by miscalculation or a war by accident. I assert we still have those dangers today. A miscalculation, we don't have a Cuban Missile Crisis, but we have Ukraine, and we have potentially have the Baltics. If there is a Russian incursion into the Baltics, God hopes that it doesn't happen, but if there's a Russian incursion into the Baltics, comparable to what they had in Ukraine, that would bring NATO troops and Russian troops into some sort of a military conflict. The danger then of a military escalation to a nuclear is very real if that happens. We also have the danger still of a false alarm. What set the conditions for a false alarm in the Cold War was we had a policy known as launch on warning. We still have a policy of launch on warning. Whether or not a false alarm would lead to a launch depends on many factors, but mostly I would say it depends on what I would call context. The reason the three false alarms during the Cold War did not result in a launch was context. Nothing was going on at that time that suggested there would be an attack. Had any of those false alarms occurred during the Cuban Missile Crisis, for example, or during the Mideast crisis we had, it might have been a very different story. So technically, the launch on warning still plays. It still could happen. What about context? Well, I assert the context today is about as bad as it was during the Cold War. What context am I talking about? Let me just give you a few examples. First of all, Russia has conspicuously dropped their no-first-use policy and sort of suggested that nuclear weapons would be their weapon of choice if they were faced with some sort of a military crisis. I think more importantly, they are now undertaking a major rebuild of the nuclear arsenal, a major rebuild, well advanced in it, and publicly declaring it, almost flaunting it. I have no doubt that the United States is going to follow suit in that, and we have another nuclear arms race underway, comparable to the one we had during the Cold War. I'll have more to say about that, but that's the context that I'm talking about now. And the third part of the context is the rhetoric. Mostly, in this case, one-sided, mostly Russia to the United States, but not entirely. I look, for example, to the head of Russia media and stating publicly that Russia is the only nation that can turn the United States into radioactive ash. Now, that is obviously true. The question is, why would the head of Russian media think that was a good thing to state publicly? I look to the leaked announcement about the amazing robotic submarine that they have and all the catastrophes that it was going to be able to inflict on the United States. And perhaps most dramatically, the Russian scientist who suggested, wouldn't it be interesting if they dropped a nuclear bomb on Yellowstone? Why on Yellowstone? Because there's a huge dormant volcano at Yellowstone, which if it erupted could cause immense damage. And so his brilliant idea was we could use a nuclear bomb to trigger that volcano and thereby destroy the United States. Now, this, I believe, is bluster, simply bluster. The question, though, is why does the Russian government believe it is reasonable to encourage such bluster? That's the context I'm talking about. And the context is something that is very serious we need to be concerned about. Let me go on then to the accidental nuclear war. As I said, we still have the launch on warning. We still have the context. We need to be concerned about the day, just as we are concerned about it during the Cold War. To be clear, I think the danger of a nuclear war by accident or by miscalculation is lower today than it was during the Cold War, happily. But beyond that, we have two new possibilities of a nuclear war, which did not exist during the Cold War. One of them, obviously, is nuclear terrorism, which I place at a very high probability sometime in the next couple of years. It is simply an event waiting to happen. And so the threat is real. In a sense, we are living on borrowed time. And the threat is much, much more consequential than most people understand. People think of it as sort of a big 9/11. Big is not quite the right term. It's two orders of magnitude more consequential than 9/11. And beyond the fatalities or casualties that would occur from it, there are the social, the economic, and the political consequences, which should be very considerable. In the preface to my book, I lay out what I call nuclear nightmare, my nuclear nightmare. And I imagine a nuclear terror attack in Washington, just a few blocks from where we're sitting. And I imagine the consequences, the political, not just the casualties, but the political and the economic and social consequences that have. And they are really astounding. So I would call that to your attention. I've also prepared a little 5-minute video imagining that scenario unfolding, which I call to your attention. If you look on our website, the W.J. Perry Project website, you'll see that video. And I encourage you to do that. Besides the possibility of nuclear terrorism today, which I said is new and different from the Cold War, there's the problem of a regional nuclear catastrophe. The most obvious example being a war between India and Pakistan, which escalates into a nuclear war. That is all too easy to imagine. And the consequences of a nuclear war between India and Pakistan, besides causing tens of millions of deaths in India and Pakistan, the consequences would truly be worldwide, including the possibility of a nuclear winter effect, which could affect the whole planet. Beyond the India-Pakistan, There's the always present worry about what in the world is North Korea doing and what might they do in the future. Again, their rhetoric is just off the scale. This was only a month or so ago. They were promising to drop nuclear bombs on the United States. Again, a lot of that is bluster, but we should not underestimate the potential of North Korea or India and Pakistan blundering into a nuclear war, of which we would be, which we would suffer significantly. So those are, that's the context in which I make my comment, that the, which I repeat now, which is the possibility of a nuclear catastrophe today is really greater than it was during the Cold War. But we are supremely and blissfully unaware of that. And that's why I feel a particular responsibility to try to educate the public on this issue. Many other people in this room have that same responsibility. Joe Cicrincione in particular, through the Plowshares, has worked diligently and effectively in that area. The question, of course, is what should we do about all of this, aside from just trying to sound the alarm? And I suggest there are a few specific actions which we should be thinking about. One of them, and fundamentally, is to try to deal with this context problem. And nothing can be done in that area unless we seriously re-engage Russia at the highest political levels, president to president. I'm urging that on our own president to date without success. We're urging it on the Russian president. Everything we can do to try to promote this idea that until our two presidents re-engage, at least on the issue of nuclear dangers, we're not going to change that context. We have to provide the conditions which will set the stage where the rhetoric will be toned down. Secondly, I think we should be rethinking the starting of a new nuclear arms race. You know, I lived through the one in during the Cold War, and I think one in a century, one in a lifetime is quite enough. And in particular, in a modest way, I propose one action which we could take, which is in our own reconsideration of rebuilding our Cold War nuclear arsenal, if we decide to omit the one element of the triad, which I think is most dangerous, which are ICBMs. I argue two points. First of all, that we have sufficient, more than sufficient, deterrent capability between our submarine forces and our bomber forces. And secondly, the ICBM forces have one quality peculiar to them and not to the other two, which is their susceptibility to false alarm. As long as we have ICBMs, we're going to have something like a launch on warning policy. As long as we have a launch on warning policy, we have the possibility of a false alarm, and in the wrong context, a false alarm which could lead to an accidental nuclear war. I and others have for years tried to effect changes in our policy about how we deal with warning. They've been largely unsuccessful. And so I'm going to the supreme conclusion that the way to do is simply eliminate the ICBMs and the launch on warning problem goes away. So this is what I'm proposing so far to very little effect, but I will keep proposing it anyway. The third thing we need to do is get serious about controlling fissile material, and I'm happy to say that one really major successful policy of this administration has been the nuclear summits, directed precisely to the action which could greatly reduce the possibility of nuclear terrorism, namely controlling the fissile material. And if we are successful in that, we greatly reduce the probability of a nuclear terror act. And one of the things which I and others have been proposing is that we do not stop this effort with this fourth and final nuclear summit, that we find some way of continuing, either future summits or at least a way of institutionalizing what has been done so far, the good that's been done already by these summits. And finally, there's a question of, again, focused on nuclear terror attack. The key, of course, in any terror attack is the good intelligence so that you can prevent the terror attack from taking place. In this case, the intelligence ought to be very precisely focused. to the question of fissile material. What's happening to it, who's trying to get it, who might have succeeded in getting it. So a very sharpened focus on our intelligence in this area. Those are four modest recommendations I would make. I'd like to conclude my comments here by noting that this has been a long and I should say very often frustrating battle. And many of you who are engaged in the same struggle here will share my frustration about how hard it is to try to get real results. And so I've been asked by my friends and colleagues why in the world I pursue this seemingly futile attempt, particularly at my somewhat advanced age. Why don't I simply retire and enjoy my golden years in that Garden of Eden known as Palo Alto? And I say, well, this is a serious problem, and time is not on our side. Besides which, I helped create this arsenal. I have some special responsibility, some special knowledge about what can be done to try to back away from it. And so I end sometimes by quoting Robert Frost, which is, "The woods are lovely, dark and deep, but I have promises to keep and mouths to go before I sleep, and mouths to go before I sleep." Thank you. I'm going to turn the podium over to my friend and colleague, Governor Jerry Brown, who has had an absolutely distinguished career as governor of California. Most importantly, from my point of view, he's not only led the nation, but led the world in the efforts to get climate change under control. And now he is putting some of his same interest and attention to the question of what could he do to deal with the other existential problem, which is a nuclear catastrophe. Governor Brown.
Thank you, Bill. And I am here because Bill told me to be here. And I'm glad to do so. So I come at this thing, obviously, not from the point of view of a national official or a scientific expert. I come at it from someone who's observed the democratic process, the political process, politics, campaigning, public opinion, propaganda, and all that goes into that general hurly-burly world that I've spent most of my life in, and sometimes succeeding at. That's one thing to say. I've been up and I've been down. I'm up right now. I've been in and I've been out, and I'm in. I can tell you it's better to be in than be out, so. Most of the people I started with are not here anymore. So I don't know what satisfaction that is, but most of my adversaries have departed this world, at least the early ones in the 70s. So here I am, kind of a survivor. So I speak from the point of view of survivorship. And I do want to comment on a couple of concepts of former Secretary Perry. One is the danger has never been greater, and the public is blissfully unaware. And that's something I've given a lot of thought to. Big dangers, public unawareness. And the topic that I first really looked at in this regard is climate change. And it was just a couple of years ago, there was virtually no news on climate change. In fact, I would hold meetings and agreements with scientists and doing lots of things on this topic, and there'd be media there, and I'd say, you will not write about climate change. Climate change is not news. And thinking about the nuclear danger, it struck me that the end of the world is not news either. So it's not something you're going to hear about. The big, big issues are very hard to grasp. The small minds of the political world do much better on very conventional kind of issues. And there is a certain routinization about the political process. You can't just talk about anything. what is thrown out is what you show up in, and those become the issues. And it just happens that before the Paris conference, or a little, and leading up to that, there wasn't really much talk about climate change. That didn't mean it wasn't important. It wasn't something we had to deal with. It was. But these large, possibly or inevitably catastrophic outcomes, if they're not handled, are not something that the political media or the political mind very easily deals with. And so working in the field of climate change, where California has taken a real lead, under both Republicans and Democrats, very significant. And now in California, we have initiated memorandums of understanding with over 130 states, provinces, and even countries to commit each of the signatories to keeping, to arriving at a level consistent with a rise of only 2 degrees centigrade or 2 tons per capita greenhouse gas emissions by 2050. So this was a move where, while nation states are dealing with it, states also could play a role, and in fact, many states are playing a role. Again, it's this issue that, yes, it's local, but it's also global. So no matter what California or the U.S. or any other country do, it really requires a real global commitment. That's climate change. Now, in the nuclear proliferation or nuclear materials and terrorism getting hold of these materials, that's also something that one country can't deal with alone. It does take cooperation. And so whatever the politics are, there has to be cooperation with almost, well, hopefully all the countries of the world. And so there is the conflict, if you look at the presidential campaigns, certainly with Russia and the United States. But the fact is that without Russia and the U.S. collaborating, we're not going to deal effectively with the threat of nuclear materials getting in the wrong hands, and those materials being fashioned into a nuclear device, and that device going off and causing catastrophic damage. That's the threat, and the solution does not lie just in Washington, although it lies there in many respects for contributing to the solution. It lies in all these other capitals. And so we have to have negotiation, dialogue, discussion, and that runs into the problem that there are all these issues, Ukraine, Syria, all sorts of things. But the fact that these issues are real doesn't mean that the danger of nuclear terrorism isn't equally real, or the danger of miscalculation. Last night we saw the first preview of Command and Control. Many of you may have seen that book, Command and Control. It talks about this accident in Arkansas in 1980, which didn't get much attention, but which happened, they blame it on human error, but actually the machine that had a warhead capable of having more firepower than all the weaponry in World War II, including Hiroshima and Nagasaki, that one little warhead could have blown up and could have killed hundreds of thousands of people in Arkansas. It didn't go off. It still blew up. People were hurt. But what caused it? Somebody dropped a bolt, and the bolt bounced and put a hole in the tank, and the tank started leaking, and then that reduced the pressure, and pretty soon the thing could have blown up. I can't give you all the technical reasons, but there it was. This was a serious thing. And of course, they said the bomb was perfect. The machine was perfect. It was the human beings that were in error. Well, human beings are always going to be in error. And we're creating machines that, when in the hands of human beings, can go wrong and will go wrong. It's only a matter of time. So it isn't just Secretary Perry who say we've made it by luck without a nuclear catastrophe. That's what Robert McNamara, he also said that. And a number of others have said it. We've made it by luck. Well, that in itself, just looking at a political philosophy based on luck, that's not good enough. And I think it's also well to remember something I've noticed. There are a lot of dumb ideas that get currency. And things that we think are so important in one period, they're not so important later. That's one of the things I've noticed since I started my statewide political career in 1970 when I ran for Secretary of State. So here we are decades later, and I've noticed many ideas that sounded good then don't sound so good now. Let's take the idea of building 70,000 nuclear weapons. Now that's a dumb idea, and we had to back away from it. Well, is it a dumb idea today, but was it a smart idea when we did it? No, it was dumb then, but we didn't see it. And so that's why you've got to think, what dumb ideas are we so embedded in that we don't have enough distance to notice their stupidity? We heard about the phrase bolt out of the blue. Now, Secretary Perry says that was not much of a threat, but that was a big thing. I've been around long enough to remember when massive retaliation, that was the doctrine. Then mutual assured destruction. And then I heard about window of vulnerability back to the 1980 presidential campaign. That was one of the issues, the MX missile, going to take it around on trains. And I said, instead of carrying around an MX missile, why don't we get a bullet train, which we're now doing in California, by the way. So a lot of these ideas, people took them pretty seriously. And we know in the Cuban Missile Crisis, there was a Russian submarine that had a nuclear torpedo, and that there were American ships going after that submarine, forcing it to surface. And submarine thought it was under attack. And two of the three decision makers said, fire away that nuclear torpedo. Well, if that had happened, that might have been the end. That might have started the escalation cycle, but it didn't. Again, we were lucky. And so luck is a big part of this. And how long is the luck going to go on? So all that has to say, and I can tell you just from what I see, you can't rely totally that politicians either know what they're doing or are telling you the complete truth about what they're doing or about what they're concerned about. They're just human like anyone else. And we're dealing with a very inhuman technology, namely the power to blow up the world, to blow up a city, to spread radioactive material in a dirty bomb. These are big, serious issues that are not rhetoric. A lot of the campaigning is about, you know, stories and rhetoric and all sorts of things. But there's some real stuff going on. Climate change is real. Just look at the Washington Post today, the New York Times, about the West Antarctic, how the sea level, just from that alone, will be up 3 feet within the lifetime of many people alive today. Then you're going to get another 2 or 3 feet from other places, other causes. This is serious stuff. And whether the people in Florida want to believe in climate change, they're at risk, as are the people in New York City and Beijing and Hong Kong and many other places. So big risk, but are we mobilizing to deal with it in a way that's commensurate to the challenge? Answer, no, not at all. We're getting there, but we're not there. So the same thing, I believe, with the nuclear danger. We got to get more serious. And that means our leaders have to get out of the comfort zone and do everything humanly possible and technically possible to reduce the threat of terrorism, the threat of mistake, the threat of accident, miscalculation. All these things are possible. Human beings make mistakes, and we're building such immeasurably powerful machines. How can human beings ever contain that? Only by reducing and pulling back from where we've advanced to. Now, that's not easy, but these are human problems, and human beings can solve them. So that's why it's so important to deal with this issue, with all these other things we're talking about. When I say we, the political class, dealing with their various campaigns and speeches, there's big issues, and those big issues, climate change and nuclear catastrophe, are real. just because you don't read about it every day. It's time to think about it, reflect on it, and do everything possible to avert it. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Governor Brown, for a very inspiring and important remarks, and thank you, Secretary Perry, for your thoughts as well. And I wanted to ask a couple of questions, but really open it to the audience. So when it's time, please raise your hand. Secretary Perry, I was really taken by your sort of core remarks regarding the danger of nuclear terrorism. I think you said it's a very high probability that we might suffer an attack by terrorists, and I think you said within the next few years. And so I really wanted to sort of get your sense. You're a mathematician for life, as all mathematicians are. What are sort of the data points that you're seeing? What specifically sort of are you seeing that makes you so concerned about this threat within such a short amount of time? What sort of are the major trends that you're seeing that worry you the most about that?
Well, I've been concerned since the formation of Al-Qaeda, and particularly the discovery when we defeated them in Afghanistan, that they actually were planning and studying how to get a nuclear weapon to use it. I have no doubt that had they been able to get one, they would have used it. Fortunately, they were not able to get one. Today, why I'm more concerned about it, I'm more concerned because the primary potential perpetrator, would be ISIL. The difference between ISIL and Al-Qaeda is ISIL is larger, it's better organized, and most importantly, it's much better funded, much greater resources. So the probability of their being able to get the fissile material is much higher than it was for Al-Qaeda. So I think the probability is higher today than it was back in the days of Al-Qaeda, simply because of the fact that ISIL is better funded and better organized. If I put myself in the position of, God forbid, of being an ISIL head and said, what would I be doing to carry out this plan, it's easy for me to formulate a plan to do it that has a reasonable chance of success. So I do not see this as a remote possibility at all. We've got the people who want to do it, they have the resources to do it, and it's just a matter of time, I think, till they succeed in getting enough fissile material. If they get enough, whatever it is, 50 pounds or so of highly enriched uranium, I have no doubt they can build what's called an improvised nuclear bomb. Now, improvised, don't make a mistake. This is a bomb that goes off with the power of the Hiroshima bomb. So improvised just means the way it's packaged, it can be, they will not make it compact to put in a warhead. It'll be a big, clumsy apparatus which goes in a truck and not a warhead. But from our point of view, for nuclear terrorists, suffering nuclear terrorism, the truck is quite sufficient to do the job. Indeed, that's, in my hypothetical scenario of an attack on Washington, that was the means of delivery. So the motivation is there. The means of getting the fissile material are not that difficult if you have the resources. They have the resources, they have the motivation. That's why I say
it. See, I want to comment on that. Here you have former Secretary of Defense saying the materials are out there in the world, that there's a group with the motivation and the capability of getting it. And if you look at his video on, what is the web page?
This is wjperryproject.org. That's our web page. And if you go to that web page, you can click a 6-minute video which imagines the scenario taking place, the nightmare scenario. I think it's a very effective video. I'd encourage you to go to the web page, click that site, and spend 6 minutes to watch the video.
See, I think the fact that a former Secretary of Defense has a video like this ought to get our attention. And you know, we know in history, great leaders, great educated leaders, great moral people do really stupid things. Just take World War I. You had a lot of good Christian European leaders who probably had great educations, and they really screwed up things in ways that we're still paying for. So we ought to know that a human being can do some pretty horrific things, and now with nuclear, it's unimaginably more catastrophic. But just take this matter of a terrorist nuclear bomb in Washington. If you could blow up half the Congress and kill the president and the vice president, what happens to America? Is there an America left as we have known it since the founding of the Republic? Probably not. So is that a risk? 1 in 100? 1 in 1,000? Whatever it is, that risk is too high not to do every single thing possible to avert it. Are we doing everything possible to avert it? No. We're engaged in a lot of other activities that are blocking the focus on this existential threat that we know, at least if we believe Bill Perry, this is real. And yet, if you look through your paper today, you're not going to see it's too real. Now, there is a summit. That's good. But that doesn't mean they even have a plan to deal with all the nuclear material that is loose in the world, because they don't. And if they don't, is that important to do something about it? I would say yes. So hope we get a response here, and because it's real. And if they don't do it tomorrow, well, I'll keep bugging them as long as I'm around. I'll tell you that.
Great. Let me drill down on a part of this that I think is really important. We'll spend just a little more time on your sense, both of your senses of the conditions that are leading to this really concerning danger, and that is the loose, the sort of the amount and sort of locations of the of loose fissile material that you think can be developed into a bomb. What are the trends you're seeing there? Is it easier now to get your hands on these kinds of materials than it was 10 years ago, 15 years ago? And then if you could also, this is part of this is education. Can you also talk about the difference between a dirty bomb, you know, a radiological device, and what you called an improvised nuclear weapon? Those two issues, I think, are worth spending some time on.
I think it was much easier to get the material 5 or 10 years ago than it is today. For one thing, there's less of it today. And another thing, the action of the nuclear summit has gotten quite a bit of that material off the streets and under better control. The most significant and important thing we've done dealing with the problem I'm concerned about has been done as a result of the nuclear summit. I think that's been a tremendous achievement. It just hasn't gone far enough. And I'm fearful it's going to stop with this meeting today. So we need to do something to keep that effort going. It's not something you do and it's done. It's a process. You just keep working and keep working, because there's a huge amount of fissile material out there. Some of it's still under very, very loose control. We still have people who have research reactors using fissile material, and it's just not necessary. You can do the research without using the fissile material. So there's lots of things that can be done to improve. We've done great improvements in the last couple of years, but a long way to go yet. That was the first one. The dirty bomb question. I don't talk much about that because I don't want people to confuse the catastrophe of a real nuclear explosion with the relatively bad news of a dirty bomb. It's a very different, two orders of magnitude different. The dirty bomb, of course, is putting radioactive material on a regular bomb and blowing it up. And so maybe a few people are killed by the bomb, but the dirty bomb then causes the contamination of the area, and it renders some area, maybe some reasonably large area, a couple blocks in the city, say, economically unusable for a long time. So it's somebody called a weapon of disruption rather than of destruction. And I'm not minimizing that. I just say it does not compare with the catastrophe they would have of a real nuclear bomb going off.
I see. And Governor Brown, I think you've been very passionate about the difference between...
Oh, excuse me. Just one of the even in the case of the dirty bomb, there are lots of things we can do that we're not doing now, because the radioactive material they could use is not fissile material now. It's cesium. It's out there in thousands of facilities because it's used for medical purposes. A lot can be done to get better control of that, and should be done. I just want to separate it from the problem of a nuclear bomb going off.
I see. Governor Brown, how can we all go about sort of closing this gap that you've been so passionate about between the danger and the sort of relative apathy of a public, of policymakers? Should this be discussed in the ongoing campaign? Sort of, what do you think are the best levers for us sort of achieving this goal of education and then action?
Well, I think this is quintessentially a role for national leaders. It's really something, certainly primarily the president and the presidents of other countries. The ball is in their court. They have the power. But there are subsidiary leaders in the United States Senate and the Congress. There's a budget process to consider the nuclear arms buildup. That's an opportunity to talk about what the goals are, what are alternatives mm-hmm. to what is being proposed. I think that's there. I think there are people in the media who write about these things. There are questions and debates. If you go back and do a word search for what's been talked about in the presidential debates, you'll see virtually nothing about the range of nuclear danger that has been talked about just in the last half hour. So that reflects a judgment on a part of all the people who conducted the debates that what we're talking about today is not important, or it's not true. It's got to be one or the other. Because if they believed, and I mean all the different TV stations and questioners, if they believed everything Bill Perry believed, there would have been some questions and some follow-up on this topic. But there wasn't. So that tells you that's an area where there should be, there can be some initiative. So I think there. I've mentioned those levels. And then I think people have to, just as a matter of the formation of public opinion, what's the hierarchy of threats? Or what's the hierarchy of issues? What's the most important thing? And you think of all the issues that people are talking about, and let's weigh them on one side, decapitating the American government with an improvised nuclear bomb. Where would you rate that, along with the various issues that you read about today in the paper? Or a nuclear, one of these accidents, which have occurred many times about a nuclear accident. And as Bill made a point, and I want to emphasize it, he talks about context. Now, if everything's all peaceful and there's some 200 missiles coming your way, well, maybe that's a mistake. But if you're in the middle of a Cuba Missile Crisis confrontation or some other high degree of hostility and something comes up, you won't have the same tolerance level to take the time to figure it out. So I just think that what's needed is for anybody who has any access to opinion or power to put into the balance of consideration the real weight of the nuclear danger. And I would add climate change, which we have, which is a longer lived, but each of these have similar, are similar in this respect. Even though the worst part of climate change is down the road, if you wait for down the road, it's too late. You've got to operate before you don't have full complete information. The same thing about many of the decisions we're making now. The momentum can build. If we're going to have, over the next three decades, close to $1 trillion of nuclear investment, that's a momentum. And we won't be by ourselves. There'll be a response, and mm-hmm. there'll be other countries that will do that. And if we think of the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty and Article 6, the nuclear powers are supposed to negotiate on total disarmament of nuclear weapons. Well, that's pretty much of a dead letter. So I think there's a lot of awareness that would be very useful, starting right in the political, going to the media, and then whatever other organs of power exist in our society.
Thank you. Let me ask one last initial question, and then I'll look for hands in the audience. But let me turn the clock back to 2009. I think it was April when President Obama gave the Prague speech, which was laid out his vision of a world without nuclear weapons and also his recognition of the importance of maintaining a safe, secure, and effective U.S. arsenal, you know, as we're moving towards that world, and still the need for deterrence because regional conflict hasn't gone away. Since then, I think, as you said, Secretary Perry, a lot of progress on the track of securing and controlling and getting a handle on fissile materials. But I have to say, on the other track, the trends had been very, very, very bad. The U.S. Did come to an agreement with Russia on the New START treaty, which was very helpful indeed. And so U.S. and Russian warheads were capped, and there were various other limits. But every other country has been really building. China has been building. Pakistan, I think, is building at a more rapid rate than any other country on Earth. And almost every country except for France and the United Kingdom, I think, with nuclear weapons, Russia included, is increasing the role of nuclear weapons in their security strategy and increasing their arsenals. So how can we now sort of restart a process where the arsenals of the powers that do have nuclear weapons are brought sort of, the acceleration is reversed at some point and capped? It's a difficult world for the United States to try to sort of advance this kind of initiative because no one else is doing it.
When President Obama made his speech in Prague, I really thought we were set for major progress in this field. And for a few years, we did have major progress. The New START Treaty, the summit started. Very important changes were made. But then everything came to a grinding halt, and now we're moving in reverse instead of forward. I can't give you a full explanation, geopolitical explanation of why all that happened. But I think it's probably true that the president, after 2 or 3 years after his Prague speech, decided that there was a political loser. And gave up trying to push those things. He gave up, for example, a follow-on of the New START Treaty. He gave up trying to get the CTBT ratified. And I think that was a political judgment, probably a correct political judgment on his part, that he could not succeed in them. It seems to me that the first and most critical thing, that some of this was no doubt influenced by the rapidly deteriorating relationship between the United States, the hostility, really, between the United States and Russia. So it seems to me, without doubt, that the first major thing that has to be done is address that underlying problem. And I don't know of any better way of addressing it than, as I said before, the two presidents re-engaging that whatever the differences are, whatever the difference between our two countries are, we do have a common interest in preventing a nuclear catastrophe. And they should be re-engaging on that issue. And in particular, they could focus on one specific point, which is what can our two countries do to prevent ISIL from getting a nuclear bomb and using it against either Washington or Moscow. I think Moscow is as much at risk here as Washington is. That's something we have in common. And if we got working together on that, maybe we could create a climate where we could start dealing with other issues as well. I want to just tell you one more thing, Barry, why I feel so strongly about this. The second month after I became Secretary of Defense, I went over to Ukraine. Ash Carter and I had started a program to try to dismantle all of the nuclear weapons which were in the three countries, Ukraine, Belarus, and Kazakhstan, which had inherited them after the Soviet Union broke up. And the biggest site of all was a place called Pervomysk. And so we went over to Pervomysk to oversee the beginning of the dismantlement of those weapons. And we arrived at the site in Pervomysk, and the general who was in charge of that site took us on a tour. We went down to the control center for the Pervomysk site. And there were two young lieutenants sitting there at the control center, and they'd been told to do a show and tell for the distinguished visitors. And so what they did is they went through a practice countdown, up to but not including the last step. Those two 20-something lieutenants had buttons in front of them, which if the two of them had pressed it, would have set off 200 warheads, all aimed at targets in the United States. 200, just that one site, there were two young lieutenants there. And they could have destroyed the United States, basically. Those two young men. And I sat there watching that. It just struck me in a way it never struck me before, the complete absurdity of what we were doing, the complete absurdity of it all. Now, I've never forgotten that moment. Mm-hmm. And it's one of the factors which has driven me to where I am today. It certainly drove me to write that book. trying to educate other people on this, because if some people can vicariously experience some of the things I experienced, maybe they would have a very different view on how dangerous this problem is and the imperative of taking real action about it.
And if I could just add, the scenario that you paint in the beginning of your book, I mean, a sort of a fictional but very, very possible scenario of a terrorist use of a weapon in Washington is very gripping. I strongly commend the Secretary Perry's book, but also I think these are very real types of things that can happen, and a very scary, concerning picture that you paint. But we can do. There's things we can do to reduce the danger. I had a question. First question in the middle there.
Thank you, Doyle McManus from the Los Angeles Times. Secretary Perry, you've been promoting the idea of eliminating the land-based ICBMs for some time. It's a sensible idea. It reduces vulnerability. It's even economical. So I'd like you to be a political analyst and analyze the pushback and the lack of traction you've gotten. And Governor Brown, is this an issue you plan to spend more time on, not just the ICBMs, the nuclear issue, in the years to come? What can a governor do, and what can a post-governor do?
A post-governor can do less than a governor. I can answer that right
now. A post-secretary can do less than the secretary also.
So, Secretary Perry, what's the political, I think the first question was, what's the political, you know, how can your proposal to eliminate one of the three legs of the nuclear triad, as we call it, get some traction?
I may be pursuing Mission Impossible, and this, the pushback on this, is, as you might imagine, is enormous. I think I'm making little or no headway on it. My rationale is simple, though, and it's twofold. First of all, between our submarine forces and our airborne forces, we have more than enough deterrence capability, more than enough reliable, assured deterrence capability. And secondly, the ICBMs, as I said, have this peculiar problem in that they are susceptible to a false alarm leading to a accidental nuclear war. I don't want to overstate the case. It's a low probability. We've survived many years without it ever happening. But during the Cold War, I believed that it was a risk we had to take, and I didn't pursue it then. Today, I believe it's a risk we do not have to take. So I say, why do we take it? We can get our deterrence without that. So the logic is simple, not effective, but simple. So,
and do you think, just to be clear, for those who don't know, the Russian forces, a significant proportion of their triad is based on land. And so would you recommend this move regardless of what Russia does?
I say just from our own security point alone, looking unilaterally at U.S. security, that's what I would recommend. I have no reason to believe, in fact, I highly doubt that the Russians would follow suit. The bulk of their retaliatory forces, insurance forces, is in land-based ICBMs, although they are starting to move more effectively towards submarine forces now.
And then, Governor, you're in charge of one of the largest economies in the world. How do you plan to, I think the other question was, how do you plan to pursue this agenda?
Also in charge as president of the regents of the two weapons labs that are busily designing next generation modernization, quote and unquote. Also, California, my alma mater where I went, is the home of where the first nuclear bomb was actually developed, McConnell Hall, on the Berkeley campus. So we have a lot of connection there to the nuclear world. And just having been through this conversation for the last many decades, it seems like ideas that were obsolete 30 years ago are still brought back as fresh a notion. And one of the words I haven't heard discussed today is escalation and the nature of escalation, which is the more you do, the more I'll do. And the more I do, the more you'll do. That's called escalation. It's a form of addiction. And the key concept in addiction is the next jolt is not like the last one, because you need more. And in the nuclear escalation, you have to keep rising, you have to keep upping the ante. But by the time you've moved up the escalation ladder, the world is a much more dangerous place. The complexity, the room for error is much higher. And this is something Robert Oppenheimer said about that the world was headed in the direction of hell at a high rate of speed with a positive rate of acceleration. And he was thinking of this notion of escalation, I think. So reason I've heard all these bad ideas a long time, and I've been led to think a lot about this notion of deterrence, because deterrence is the kind of the talisman that justifies all response and activity. Deterrence, robust deterrence, effective deterrence, extended deterrence. Many, there's all kinds of brands of deterrence. But then what is deterrence? What is deterrence? It's, if you do something to me, I'm gonna do something to you. Now the question, what is that something? Well, some people think you can put up a defense shield. Well, a lot of people, and I think Secretary Perry is one of them, doesn't think you can do that. So the only thing you can do is do a lot of damage. You blow us up, we'll blow you up. That was mutual assured destruction, MAD. That was talked about 30 years ago. We haven't really escaped from MAD, as far as I can tell. And now, what do you need for mutual assured destruction? Obviously, we thought we needed 70,000 weapons of all kinds. Now, the number is down, I don't know, with 5,000, 7,000. You count the ones in reserve, I don't know how many there are. Somewhere between 5,000 and 10,000 nuclear warheads. So now, do you need that many? How many do you really need? Many people think you need the triad. You need the subs, you need the planes, you need the ICBMs. Secretary Perry says, no, you only need 2 out of 3. Some people may say you only need 1. China only has 400 or so, but now they're building, they're getting along with the program, so they get to escalate too. So it's a very squishy concept that undergirds the entire topic of nuclear escalation. How much, when is enough enough? And in addiction, enough is never enough, and the only outcome is usually either you stop by letting it go, or you collapse, you overdose. And so those are kind of the two ways. Either you get off it, or it goes off, and there's no, and you're not there anymore. So I think that's why I'm interested in this topic, A, because I like to survive, and I'm interested in the prevalence of dumb ideas in politics. And I've seen a lot of them, and this whole topic here, the unserious approach to such an overwhelming catastrophic danger inclines me to think about it, speak where I can, and join the secretary when he asks, and also to try to nudge people in what I call a more coherent direction. And I do think that this issue is not the prerogative or the province of the nuclear priesthood. We're in a democratic society, and public issues should be publicly debated. And an issue of survival certainly deserves to be debated. And as the elected executive in America, who's been elected by more votes than anyone else other than the president, I feel I ought to speak about it, and so I will.
Great. Thank you very much. I think this gentleman here was next, so if we can bring a microphone to him.
Secretary Perry, both China and the US are accusing each other militarizing the South China Sea, and is there a miscommunication on South China Sea and the other issues? And because Barack Obama is meeting with the Chinese President Xi Jinping today, well, how would you advise the leaders of both parties?
It's a question about the South China Sea, but I think certainly relevant today. I think we have a lot, there's renewed competition sort of among great powers like China, Russia, and the United States. So this makes this danger more concerning, I think, the danger of miscalculation.
No, I think escalation. It's highly unlikely that the United States and China would blunder into a nuclear war. But what's going on in the South China Sea now concerns me because it does provide a context again. And it's easy. I would don't believe for a moment that either China or the United States would contemplate a nuclear war against the other. But I do believe that the forces are underway right now in the South China Sea could lead us to blunder into some kind of a military conflict. Not one which the President of China wants and not one which the President of the United States wants. But when you have military forces out at sea coming, rushing into each other, the decisions don't get made by the President, they get made by the ship commanders or the airplane pilots. And they can conduct actions which cause some kind of a military conflict, and then you have to worry about the danger of escalation. So I don't want to paint a grim picture here. As I said, what I start off by saying, I think there's no reason to believe, and I'm not concerned, that U.S. and China would ever get into a nuclear war. But I am concerned that we are in a situation now where we could get involved, where we could blunder into some kind of a military conflict. And I think that's unnecessary danger, and that the way to deal with that is to deal with the underlying issue, which is why is there conflict in the South China Sea now? What can we do to resolve that conflict? It's not primarily a United States issue. It's an issue between China and the other nations in the region. But the United States has an interest in it because we have a lot of ship traffic that goes through the South China Sea. So we are concerned. But I think it's dumb that we have that kind of a problem facing us today. And that the U.S. and China ought to deal with that directly and see if we can find a way of toning that down.
Thank you. Microphone to Barbara Slavin in the second row, please.
Thanks very much, Barbara Slavin from the Atlantic Council. Governor Brown, when your father was governor, I remember being taught to duck and cover at our elementary school in Santa Monica. So that was, of course, not very useful. I have questions about Iran and North Korea. Governor Perry, what would you do to strengthen the Iran nuclear agreement? Are you concerned about their missile?
Pardon?
What would you do to strengthen the Iran nuclear agreement beyond what's already in the JCPOA? Are you concerned about the missile launches, for example? And what is your advice on North Korea? How can we re-engage this country, given its rhetoric, its actions? It seems impervious to influence. Thank you.
I don't know how to add much to your first question. I think the Iran nuclear deal was a wise move on the part of both countries, both in terms of delaying at least the time by which Iran could have a nuclear weapon, delaying considerably. And most importantly, creating an environment where there might be able to be some improvement in the governments in Iran, which could lead to an improvement in relations between the United States and Iran. There's no reason for Iran and the United States to be enemies. Iran is a great country. It's a great country with a great culture. We should find a way of our two countries living together peacefully. And this Iran nuclear deal was the first positive step in that direction, so I applaud the leaders of both countries for having come to that agreement. But it's just a step, and more important steps still lie ahead of us in the future. So I would use that as a template for what we can do in the future, rather than looking at it as the end of what we should be doing with Iran. In North Korea, I had lots of advice about what to do about North Korea in the years 2000. None of it was taken. And I think we are facing a terrible problem today with North Korea's nuclear weapons, which was entirely unnecessary. It could have been avoided had we taken the right actions 15, 16 years ago. But we cannot relive history. We are where we are now with North Korea. The best thing our governments have been able to say is that we should restart the six-party talks. And I look at the history of the six-party talks and say, why?
I mean, it's been, I don't know, 12, 13, 14 years of them, and they've been a complete exercise in futility. I do think we should find a way of restarting serious discussions with North Korea. But I would not do that. I would not advise our president to do that unless he took a precedent step. And that step was have serious discussions with the Chinese government. I would hope even that the discussions that our two presidents have about to undertake now would be have that as one of their issues. Because if one of the reasons the six-party talks have been so unsuccessful is because the United States and China have not only different views of what to do, but they had different views of what the problem was. I think there have been enough development in North Korea in the last decade that China may be rethinking their views about what the problem in North Korea is. And we might now be able to come to an agreement with China on the seriousness of the problem. And then we might be able to come to agreement with China on what to do about the problem. If the United States and China could agree on a policy for dealing with North Korea, then I think we'd have some chance of success. Any diplomacy with North Korea is going to have to involve both what diplomats like to refer to as carrots and sticks. We have lots of carrots with North Korea, but we don't have any sticks we're willing to use. The only stick we have against North Korea is going to war with them, which we're not, for good reason, not willing to do. But China has sticks, and they're one of the principal suppliers of food and fuel to North Korea. And so if we could agree on the problem is serious, then the United States and China could together put together a diplomatic strategy which has both carrots and sticks involved and which would have some chance of success. I think it is a serious problem getting worse every year. It was just, I think, a few weeks ago that North Korea just blithely announced that they were going to drop a nuclear bomb on the United States. I mean, this is bluster. This is foolish talk. But it does have some basis behind it, and that they may soon be able, in fact, to do that. Not that they could do that without suffering irreparable damage to their own country, but still, why should we let ourselves get in that position? So the basis for a deal with North Korea, I think, cannot simply be, you give up your nuclear weapons and we'll do the following things. That has been our basis for many years. That could have worked back 15 years ago when I was working on the problem. The basis today has to be something more like what Sig Hecker has suggested, what he calls his three no's. Namely, you start an interim position, negotiating position with them, where you ask them where our position is, you may not do three things. You may not build more bombs, you may not build better bombs, you may not transfer nuclear weapons or nuclear technology. And then in return, we do certain positive things. If we could get that agreement, then that greatly lowers the danger, and that also provides a platform from which we go to the next step of how to get them to give up their nuclear bombs. But the present agenda and the present approach to the six-party talks has been an exercise of futility for the last 15 years or so, and it will continue to be unless we make a major change in approach.
Thank you. I think we have time for one last question.
I just want to call attention to that. Here's Secretary Perry saying that if we avoided certain actions, we might have been able to get North Korea to avoid their nuclear bomb, but we didn't. So that, again, assuming Secretary Perry is right, underscores this reality of making big mistakes. And I think it's imperative that we reflect not only on our successes and our indispensabilities, but where we've done some things that were really not smart, and acknowledge that so we can not make more of them. And I think that's a very difficult thing to do in the political process, and particularly when there isn't much of a debate going on. Even like the inability we have a major party that won't give a vote on the comprehensive test ban. That's a real impediment. And that goes back to, what do you need for deterrence? Yeah. Do you really need new experiments, new tests? And if we have new tests, then who else has new tests? And then where's the world of all that goes forward? So it seems pretty logical that there's a more prudent pathway forward. But I wouldn't say that Washington in all its fullness, namely the executive and the legislative branch, are on that track yet.
Incidentally, on the Comprehensive Test Ban Treaty, my position is very clear and straightforward. I think it is in the supreme national security interest of the United States to ratify the Comprehensive Test Ban Treaty, never mind the diplomatic aspect of it, never mind the good feeling aspect. It is in our national security interest to do that, and we're not doing it.
I think we should end there. I think this is, especially on this last very important point, I think, which gets almost no attention in Washington. I think there should at least be vigorous debates when these issues can have such catastrophic consequences for our security, for our allies and partners, for the world. I really am just, again, thrilled to host these two great leaders who are very passionate about an agenda item that isn't getting enough attention. So before we thank them, I would implore all of you, please get involved. Please start the debate, one side or the other. We really want you to engage, because this is not an issue that's going away anytime soon. Indeed, the trends are quite worrisome. So please join me in thanking Governor Brown. And
thank you, Barry.
Thank you.
That's the best moderation I've ever heard.